we've been talking about. Last week we talked, it started in chapter 10, and we started, David, if you want to put that up on the screen. We've been talking about his Talmidim. Last week we found out that that word meant his disciple. Talmidim means disciple, but in the Hebrew it's so much deeper. We talked about how it was that we were going to hang on every word, that everything that we were as a follower, we try to get as close. We wouldn't want to miss anything. If you missed that sermon, please grab it online or grab a CD in the back. You'll want to get that because this whole series in chapter 10, we'll be talking about his Talmidim. We talked about how those guys, when they went to follow Jesus, they left everything because they realized that this rabbi above rabbis had just asked them to follow him. And they wanted to be a part of that. They wanted to follow God like this rabbi followed God. And so they gave up everything to hang on every word that they would not miss anything. They didn't know where they'd be heading. They didn't know where their destination would take them. But they were willing to give it all to follow this rabbi. And so what we are doing is we're looking at these words as if the rabbi is speaking to us. Can I tell you a little bit? I want to try to give one, at least one point every week on something that proves that he was teaching in a very rabbinic lifestyle. Did you ever notice that when he first gives the Beatitudes, what's it say about him? What did he do? He sat down and he opened his mouth. Isn't that interesting? I've always asked, why would the writer say that he sat down? Interesting. The interesting part of that is a rabbi would always sit to teach his teachings to the people. When we stand for the word of God, that was proper protocol. Why? Because that's God speaking. And if God is speaking, we stand. But when a rabbi would speak, you'd sit. When God spoke, you'd stand. When a rabbi spoke, he would sit because now it's his interpretation of what God said. So when it says that Jesus sat down and taught, that's very rabbinical. And the writer was trying to share his teaching style to us. Because remember, we want to know because these everyday normal people went from there to dying for their faith and did supernatural things. But something transferred to them in that three-year period. And how did it happen? I believe it happened because of this relationship. Let's stand for the reading of God's word. We're going to begin reading in Matthew chapter 10. And verse 5, he starts very quickly with the words in red. We're about ready to hear. Remember, we are his Talmidim, and that means we are meant to hang on every word. Let's listen to this as if though this is the first time we've heard this, and we've decided to follow him, decided to go after him, and now we're hearing these words for the first time in verse 5. Listen to our rabbi today. These 12 Jesus sent forth and commanded them, saying, here it comes, here's our rabbi. Do not go in the way of the Gentiles into any of the city of the Samaritans. Do not enter, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out devils, freely give as you've received. Provide neither gold nor silver nor brass in your purses, nor scrip for your journey, neither two coats, shoes, or staves, for the workman is worthy of his meat. In whatever city or town you enter, inquire if it is worthy, and there you shall abide to go there. And when you have come into a house, salute it, or bless it. And if that house be worthy, let your peace come upon it. But if it's not worthy, let your peace return to you. And whosoever shall not receive you, nor hear your words, when you depart out of that house or city, shake that dust off your feet. Verily I say unto you, it shall be more tolerable for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah in the day of judgment than for that city. So Jesus, these are your words. Help us to hear them. Help us to know what you're saying, Father. And we want to know deeply what to do with them. Because, Lord, hearing is not hearing if we don't take action. And so, Lord, help us to hear, to take action in Jesus' name. And everyone shouted, amen. Amen. Let us be seated. Can I ask you something? The words of the rabbi, to his Talmudim fairly simple. Can I ask you, what did you hear today? What did you hear from those words today? Or show of hands, just a hand. Dan.
Do what I do and take risks.
Do what I do and take risks. Good. Anybody else? No right or wrong answers. Just what did you... Awesome.
Specific people to do, to speak to, and specific things you can explain to people.
Yeah, so there's specifics. Good.
Go. Go to the lost sheep. Go to them.
Good.
Don't expect them to come to you.
Good. Good. This morning, if I was to be honest, when I hear the words of the rabbi today, can I tell you that there's parts of me this week that I go, you know what, God, I don't feel like preaching on this. I'm just being honest. Why? As a pastor, I've preached, I've pushed, I've prodded about the message of going, of the message of preaching to the nations, to go and make disciples. And to tell you the honest truth, I've been prodded, I've been manipulated, and I've felt guilty because of the preaching going on at the pulpit. I felt like I had to, and it was part of my salvation, and I've heard it all. So for me to stand up here as your pastor, once again, to tell you about going, I was not as excited. I sat back and I go, your disciples, your Talmudim, us, we know. And I feel like he says to me again, tell them again. Because it's not getting done. It's not over. And what I hear, and JP said it, is I hear go, go, and go. And so guys, RJ and Bill, would you guys come this morning again? I don't have two of these, so maybe we could take a handful. I'm going to start flipping out already. So we could pass those out. Take those with, yeah. So don't mess with them yet. Just take one. So I think about a stoplight. That's what I think about. I think about the red, which means what?
Stop.
Right? It means stop, right? For some. Some. Some means to stop, but it really does. When you see red, that means stop, right? The driving is meant to come to an end. How about when we see yellow? Don't turn those on yet. Turn them off. The cheaters. If you see yellow, what's it mean? Oh, yeah, for many it's speed up, right? How many of you know that truly means caution and slow down, right? Caution. Remember out on the racetrack, when the red came up, that meant stop, shut off your engines, racing's over. When yellow came on, it meant that I was still supposed to go round and round, but racing was over. You know, you would just still go round and round. You had to watch for missing or parts off of cars and oil, and you just took some caution, right? What's green mean? Okay, because I heard that in red and yellow, so just to make sure, what does green mean? No, it doesn't. It means the race is on. It means you better get going. Caution's over. It's time to go. Let's move. And if I was, look, can I ask you as serious as we can and as honest as we can, what would you say if we were to look at this as a church, not just this church, because I know this isn't us, but I'm talking about other churches and the church united across the world. In some ways, maybe even in the church today, where would you say that the church would be? Would it be a red light, a yellow light, or a green light?
Yellow.
If I am going to be as honest as I can be, I think we live in the yellow. I think we live in caution. We're still going around and around. I think about the racetrack. When that yellow light comes off, I'm still supposed to keep moving, stay in my position. But you know what? Racing's all out. All I'm doing is trying to keep the tires hot. You know, have you ever seen racers go back and forth like that? Do you know what that does? It keeps your tires hot. Okay? So I'm trying to create friction. I'm still looking like it's race. I'm going round and round. Some of us look like we're still in the race. We're still going around. But racing isn't happening. And I think that the church is in caution. We're going around and we say we want to tell people. We say we want to do something. And we say we're in the race, but the caution light's on. And we're going around going, yeah, okay, it's, yep, I'm coming around the pit again. Stop, okay, church, okay, work, okay. Yeah, it looks like I'm racing. But we're not taking any risks. We're just going around the track. But I think it's different. I think that our rabbi is telling us something different. And you might say, Pastor Lynn, you just started this whole thing saying you don't want to say it. The reason I don't want to say it because I know you know it. I'm passionate about this. Don't get me wrong. Sometimes I'm a little more open than maybe I should be sometimes because sometimes it's a little shocking. The pastor doesn't want to preach on something. I'm just telling you that I don't want to manipulate you or guilt you today or anything like that, but I will step on your toes a little bit today, but I don't think we're at the stop point. I don't think we're at caution. I think we're on green light. And ladies and gentlemen, you can, since all of you already done that, just screw that in a little bit, the back end of that. Turn that on for me. Just screw it in. Look at that. Everybody raise that up. I think the Lord's given us a green light. I think that we're at green light. Not DEFCON 4, DEFCON 5. I think we're on green light. And I think that the Lord was saying to us, get up and go. The caution's been turned off. Go. And so I gave you a green light today, which are pretty cool. You can actually tie these on the, you know, wherever you want to put them, a little light. They'll last for hours. But I gave you a green light today because I believe our rabbi is giving us a green light. And if he has given us a green light, here's what happens on a racetrack. When I'm given a green light, I believe the debris is off the track. I believe that the track managers have taken care of things. And when I see a green light, get out of my way. I'm going in, and I'm all in. I'm going to push the throttle all the way down. Why? Because I got a green light, and I was told to race, and I will not apologize because Robin is racing. I will not apologize for going all in. I remember one guy, I got in a wreck, I slammed into the wall, and I rode the wall all the way down sideways. Some of you heard that story. And I ran it all the way down, my trunk flew off and flew like a frisbee, and just about took some guys out in the pit stop, the pit area, just that were kind of directing traffic. And the guy later, I come around and I apologize to a couple of the guys because I got out into the marbles. I was racing pretty heavy, and I went out into the marbles, and it was just, you know, it was a trophy dash. It was just a trophy. It wasn't like you were the main event winner, but it was a trophy dash, but you still got a trophy. And the guy shakes my hand and goes, settle down, Lynn. He goes, it's just a piece of plastic trophy. You just hit the wall. What's the big deal? But he didn't realize I saw a green light. I had the green light. I'm going to race. It doesn't matter. I don't care if it's the warm-up. I don't care if it's just for a piece of plastic. If I'm given a green light, I'm going to do something about it because I'm put on the racetrack to race. I'm not to play cautious and wonder what's going to happen. I've been given a green light, and I'm meant to race. And here, ladies and gentlemen, today, I believe that the rabbi is saying, go. I believe he is giving us a green light to go forward. Look at what it says, and I won't go there today, but in the book of Mark, we talked about it last week. It says in the book of Mark that I've called them to be with me that I might send them. The problem is a lot of the church is being with him, but they're not being sent. See, for some reason or another, we got this idea that God wants us to be with him, and that's all that we're called to do is to be with him. But God calls us to be with him so that we can go from him with what we've been given. The Mark says this. He called them to be with him to send them. Ladies and gentlemen, if you're just with him and not going from him, you're not doing what he called you to do. If you're sitting in your little discipleship group or your little time of getting everything from your devotional life and you're writing down your dreams and your visions and what God's saying to you and you do nothing with it, it's not the fullness of the life in God. Your fullness is to spend time with him so that from him he can send you. And if you're just having your little nice devotional life, hearing the words from the rabbi and not doing anything with it, you're not doing it. He says, I want you to be with me that I might send you. He's given you the green life. He didn't save you to hold you. He didn't save you to not do anything. No, listen to these words. Lindsay, you should be impressed. I have some alliteration here. Are you ready? You were saved to be sent. You were called to be commissioned. And you were redeemed to be released. I'll say that again. You were saved to be sent. You were called to be commissioned. And you were redeemed to be released. That's the truth. And again, I can't say this enough, that if it was anything else from that, he would have preserved you and said, oh, you're saved? Come on home. But he doesn't, ladies and gentlemen. He saves you so he might send you. Because he's not here right now. You are his message to the world. Because you're not it. There's more waiting. There's more that need the message. You've been saved to be sent. You've been called to be by his side that he may send you. I think about the man that got delivered from the demons, ladies and gentlemen. And he said, Jesus, can I just go with you? I want to be with you. And he said, no, no, no. You go back home. You tell what the Lord has done today. You go share what you've been given. And ladies and gentlemen, when Jesus showed up on those shores again, thousands showed up because of one man saying, I've been freely given. I'm going to give back out. So I ask you today, is it red light, yellow, or green? Note the timing of this. I really spent some time thinking about this. Think about the timing. He says to follow. Not a lot's happened. He commissions them. He essentially calls them as his apostles, his disciples. And what happens right away? What happens right away? He gives them a green light to go out. Look at that. I mean, he just now assigned them to be his disciples. And the first direction he gives is get out of here, guys. He's trying to show a pattern. Ladies and gentlemen, they will be sooner or later sent out with the power of the Holy Spirit. But he starts right away in the calling that he's given them as, you know what, guys, I just made you apostles. Go. Right away. Now, some of you would go, okay, well, we've got that 6 hours of discipleship class I've got to take, and I want to make sure I got evangelism down, and do I have the Romans Road good enough? Some of us say, well, we're not ready. We don't have anything to say. I don't know what to do. I got problems of my own. You don't think these disciples had some problems? You don't think they'd had some work to work out? Don't you think that there was things that needed to be ironed out for them? How many of you know? They didn't have it all together. Peter was a loudmouth. There's a couple hotheads in there. There's a zealot that still probably is ticked off at Matthew. But he's like, go! I want to watch this. Right? Sends them two by two and says, go out. Go to these places. Heal the sick. Preach the word. Tell them that the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And pray for them. He doesn't wait. He doesn't say, oh, come near to me and we're going to take care. I might get a little pushy here. He doesn't take them aside and coddle them. He doesn't take them aside and make everything right for them. He doesn't give them a lot of elements to work with. He says, here's what you need to know. Here's where to go, here's what to do, and here's what to look out for. Get out of here. He doesn't say, let's heal this part of it and let's take care of this. Ladies and gentlemen, can I share something in the Gospels? I don't see Jesus dealing with personal issues a lot with the disciples. Does that mean he doesn't deal with personal issues? That's not what I'm saying. The only time he deals with some personal issues is when somebody gets an old-fashioned rebuke. Right? And some of us are sitting around waiting, ladies and gentlemen, for the Lord to do something first. Don't you already have enough? Come on, let's be serious with one. Come on. Don't you already have enough? Does anybody have something that the Lord has done for them today? Do you have something to share? Don't you have hope to share? These guys had nothing. They hadn't even spent the time that we've spent with the Lord, and still we do nothing. We still wait and we still wonder and we still, when is the right time? Now! You've got a green light to remind you that he already said to go. And if he said to go, that means you're empowered. And if you're empowered, things are going to happen. But you wonder why nothing's happened? Because you're sitting on your duff still.
Well, Lynn, you're getting kind of personal.
Yeah! You know why? Because people are dying. And you've been given something that they need. Why not? Why not? Yellow is caution. We're not there. I think it's green, 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 green. We live in a time that the light is green. It's time to go. I like how if I look at... I'm getting kind of pushy, but... Abraham says this. Abraham, as soon as he's called, what happens to him?
Get out.
Abraham?
Abraham.
Yeah?
Get out.
Right? Disciples, you're going to get the Holy Spirit. Go here, there, and beyond right away. Ladies and gentlemen, we like to build ourselves nice places to abode forever. And Jesus is saying, don't do that. Get out. Go. Don't get comfortable. Go. And I wonder if I ask this question, and this might be a pushy question. When was the last time that you laid hands on somebody and prayed? Somebody that didn't know the Lord. When was the last time you shared about the hope that is within you? When's the last time you offered a sense of encouragement to somebody that didn't know? Ladies and gentlemen, I don't care how many times you pray for Christians. That does not excite the Lord. God wants to, they're already where they need to be. Yeah, don't get me wrong. Pray for people. Don't get me wrong. But when's the last time you prayed for somebody that doesn't know him? When's the last time you took the green light that Jesus has given you? If he has said that he wants you to go, he means it. When's the last time you shared your faith? When's the last time you prayed for someone? When's the last time you said the kingdom of heaven is at hand? When's the last time you just stretched out your hand and said, you know what, could I pray for you? Well, Pastor, that's getting kind of a little pushy, yeah. But I have to ask myself the same thing. Remember, saved to be sent. called to be commissioned, redeemed to be released. Let me give you a general idea so that you don't think you're just going out there by yourself. You're already sent. Look at what he says. You're going to be going. The pattern for going, let me give you this quickly. There's three simple things that I want you to see. First one is, you don't have to worry about it. The first thing that Jesus does is he gives you direction. Look at what he says. Go here, but not here. Ladies and gentlemen, that voice to them is not the same. Back then, he says, I don't want you to go to the Gentile nations. There was a timing. But how many of you know, just as it is for them, he will tell you the same. Go here and go here. He gives direction. Not only does he tell you where to go, but he says what to do. Ladies and gentlemen, we don't serve a faraway God. He's going to share with you what he wants you to do. Go here, and when you go here, do this. Preach this and pray. Just say that with two P's real quick. Preach and pray. Preach and pray. And look at yourself, point yourself in the chest and go, that's not for the preacher, it's for me. Say it again, that's not for the preacher, it's for me. Simply put, he gives us direction, he tells us where to go, he tells us what to do. He wants us to preach and pray. Ladies and gentlemen, when he said to go make disciples, it's simply this, you need to just share. How many of you know we're seed sowers, ladies and gentlemen? We're not every time you talk to somebody, is somebody going to come to know the Lord? He says, you just go here and go here, not there. Ladies and gentlemen, there are times when God says, don't go there. And he says, go here, go there, preach and pray. He's just saying, spread the word. How many of you know seed sowing is all about throwing out as much as you can, right? And how many of you know some seeds don't bring harvest? You just get that seed out there. And I want to ask you, how much seed are you spreading? It's not like what we do at home with the corn. We poke our finger in there, we stick the corn in, and we cover that, and we pat it all nice. No, that's not what the kind of seed sowing he's talking about. He's talking about back in that day, having the big bag, taking a handful, and just spreading that stuff, and not worrying about where it's falling. Just get it out. Right? Philip, just delete that part off when you... Just about had a rhythm there and everything. But ladies and gentlemen, we're not meant to worry about that. Just spread it out. Get it out. That waitress you're going to see, ask her, does she need any prayer for anything? Ask her if there's anything going on in her life, her or him, whoever it might be. Somebody that's looking down at the store. And I just want to tell you, Jesus loves you today. It doesn't feel like it. Well, let me tell you. Man, I'm running across somebody. I'm not feeling well today. Can I just pray for you? See, ladies and gentlemen, we take evangelism as though we're the ones to do it. When we're just sent. We're just the ones sent to go and to preach and to pray. Take the word preach out of there and just say spread. Spread the news. Tell people who he is. Tell them of the good news. So the first thing is, God, these are the three D's. So, hey, sermon in 3D. You guys ready? The first one is, he gives direction, D. He's going to tell us where to go. I love what Joe said, the missionary from India during family camp. He said, you want to know the will of God? Just start saying, okay. Right? You want to know the will of God? Just start saying, okay. Oh, that needs to be done? Okay. Oh, that needs to be done? Okay. Sometimes we're sitting there praying all the day long, God, what's your will? And somebody's going, hey, I could use some help over here. Just wait, I'm praying. Right? Sometimes the Lord may say not to, but if we sit around wondering and waiting and wondering what to do, and people all around saying, hey, I want to hear about this Jesus. I want to be invited to church. I want to go where you go. Something's different about you, but we're not spreading the seed. Second one. First one was, he gives direction. Second one is, he asks us to be dependent solely on him. Look at what it says. Do not provide any gold or silver or anything else, nor scrip for your journey, shoes, or anything like that. Don't worry, a workman's worthy. Can I tell you something? He just wants our focus to be on solely him. Not that we can get any gain from what we're doing. We're not preparing in any way. Ladies and gentlemen, I want you to see what he's saying. You don't have to prepare. Don't take time to prepare for this journey. Just go. Just go. And depend on me. Ladies and gentlemen, I want you to know when he gives you direction and he calls you to be dependent, that means he's going to ask you to do things that are above your talent and above your knowledge and above your experience. But that's faith and that's our God. Because he doesn't want you to just depend on what you know and what you experienced and what you think you can do. He's going to ask you to do things you've never done above what you're comfortable with, because that's faith. Because he wants us to be more dependent on him than we are on ourselves or our experience. Complete help comes from him. And you know when that happens? He is glorified. And I want you to know that the workman is worthy. You've been employed by a great one, the master of all things. I want you to know today that you've been employed by the Most High God, and he knows your needs, ladies and gentlemen. Exactly what you need in your life, exactly what's going on. And ladies and gentlemen, I don't know about you, but when I look at laying hands on the sick that they might be healed or the dead raised, I'm all dependent on the Lord, right? When he's asking me to go out with nothing in my purse, don't get all, I'm not going to be carrying a purse, just so you know that. Just let's get that out there real quick. But fully dependent on him, so that he is glorified. Ladies and gentlemen, he uses broken vessels, so the vessels aren't glorified, but the one that fills those vessels, that can make beautiful out of the broken. Don't wait till you're all put together to do this. Do it now, because he gets the most glory. Don't do it when you have enough money or enough time or you've got all the answers. Do it now when you don't, because then you'll come back and you go, you know what happened? I was out here and these people asked me wild questions that I didn't have the answer for, and all of a sudden God downloaded their life to me and I spoke into their life everything that they needed to know, and all of a sudden they started saying, well, who is this that you serve? Ladies and gentlemen, I believe in relationship evangelism, but don't wait for relationships. Don't depend on just relationships to get the word out. Ladies and gentlemen, people are dying. They need to know. And God wants us to be dependent on him. And you know what? It's good to. It's good to lean on him. He's got gifts of the Spirit that he's ready to empower you with. He's got fruit of the Spirit to put into your life. You are a shining light in this dark world. And why wait? Why wait? When he's gifted you, he's empowered you. The whole thing is going to be above your pay scale. The whole thing. But that's where faith fills the gap. Faith fills the gap. Freely give what you've been given. Ladies and gentlemen, you got treasures in your heart and in your life. And you guys said it today. You didn't even know what I was preaching on today, Nate, but you said it. You've got experiences with the Lord. What are you doing holding on to those things? What are you doing keeping those for yourself? What are you doing? Those are treasures. Nobody can steal that away. You might say, well, I'm fearful that somebody will do this, do that. We're going to get to that in a moment. But just know this, that there's somebody that wants to hear that, somebody that needs to hear that. And nobody can take that away. They can look at you and laugh and go, well, that's you. That's not me. Go, yeah, but you can't take this. This is what he's done. And ladies and gentlemen, when I've shared the gospel of Jesus Christ with people, I want to tell you so many times I can just say, you know what? Can I tell you a little bit of my story now? Can I tell you what he's done for me? I don't have all the answers, but here's my experience. Here's what I know. And finally, we're going to move on to the final one. First one is he gives us direction. He asks us to be fully dependent on him when we go. And finally, there's decisions that are going to be made. Two decisions, ladies and gentlemen, with what's going to be going on. The first decision is simply, I receive that. And the second one is simply, I reject that. There's two decisions that will happen when you go pray, and when you go preach, and when you go share your experiences, and when you go out in the green light. Jesus told us himself that there's two things that are going to happen. Some will receive the message, some will reject the message. Don't be shocked or surprised when somebody doesn't want to hear you. Don't be shocked, and don't be shocked or surprised when somebody does. That's me. Sometimes I go, they'll say, can you tell me some more about that? Sure. You know, You know what I'm saying? Don't be shocked or surprised. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to see in these next passages, in these next few weeks, he gives us even more things to get ready for as we go out. But the first thing he wants us to know is to go. And there's going to be two decisions that will be made. They're going to receive or reject. And ladies and gentlemen, if they don't reject and they don't have anything else to say, they received it. Move on. You planted some seeds, let somebody else do the watering, and the Lord will do the harvest. Sometimes you got to know when to say something and when to shut up. Sometimes you're trying to give them the ABCs of Genesis to Revelation, and they're like, I got it. You see what I'm saying? Don't be shocked. Some don't want to hear it. And if you're waiting for that moment that you think you're going to go in and everything's going to be okay and you're all ready and prepared, yeah. Don't. The time is now. There will be some that will reject it and some that will take it. And it's time that we realize that. And when it happens, ladies and gentlemen, how many of you have ever had bad experiences when you're out there sharing the word? Anybody ever have some rejection happen? Anybody ever say some stupid things? I remember one time, can I tell you a little story? I was on a sidewalk. We were out street evangelism one night, and it was just Main Street of Libby. It's a happening place. You know, we were out street evangelism in Libby, Montana. You know, but how many of you know there's... So I'm out there, and this couple walks by, this young couple, so I start telling them about Jesus a little bit, and this is early on, and I start sharing, and I'm all jacked up and excited, and they're like, well, you know, we're just really struggling because our parents, you know, don't really want us together. And so my wisdom just says, well, you know what? Maybe if you give your heart to the Lord, he'll make all this work out. Yep. Foul ball. So, not the way to do it. You know, I'm like, well, you know, if you, you know, you come to know the Lord, he might work this out and you guys could be together. Oh, yeah, that's a great promise. Come on. You know, not how to do it. You know, but that's okay. Yeah. Right? Yeah. I look back and I learn. I felt it right when I said it, and God's going, you know, one of those moments where you hear the coughing of the Lord in the background and you know, okay, well, let's move on. But you know what? We learn. They will receive and they will reject. And you know what we do? God says here, Jesus said himself, the rabbi of rabbis tells us simply shake off the dust and just move on. Shake off that experience. Shake off the bitterness. Maybe they hurt you in some way. Maybe there were some deep wounds that happened. You guys, shake it off. I'm not going to sing. But you have to shake it off and move on. Ladies and gentlemen, back in that day, it was simply this. If you were a traveler and you came to someone's home, somebody would show you hospitality because you were walking in a very dirty land, dusty land. They would take your sandals off. They would wash your feet, and they'd welcome you into their home. What that is saying is they didn't show you the hospitality. They never washed your feet. They didn't want you. They rejected you. They didn't show hospitality, but get over it. Shake it off and move on. There's others that will. And so today, there might be some of you holding back because of bad experiences or somebody said this to me, and you know what? That's okay. Shake it off and move on. You still got the green light. He hasn't pulled you into caution. He hasn't put a stop. The green light is still shining. Shake that stuff off. Get the bitterness and the fear out and move on. There's others that do want it. And I love what the Bible says. Some of you might not like this, but Jesus was clear. There's just some places that aren't ready. And for so long, the church has preached that everybody needs to hear it, and it's every person needs this, and every... No. There are ripe ones ready. And there are some that aren't. And we seem to spend a lot of our time on the aren'ts. If they aren't, move on. If you've tried and tried and tried, move on. If you've continued to try to minister to the same person over and over again, they constantly reject, move on. You're wasting your energy. Move on. Somebody will hear. You may never, I want you to know this morning, you may never pray with someone to receive Christ as their Savior. I want you to know that this morning, but that doesn't mean you're failing. Some are seeding, some are watering. The Lord brings the harvest. Shake it off, move on. And you know what? This helps me realize something, that it's not my fault. This means that if some people reject it and some people take it, it's not my fault. And you know what the other part of it tells me? That it's not my victory either. Yeah, I can't applaud myself. I can't blame myself. I can't applaud myself or blame myself. It's just I'm a sent one. I'm a sent one. I've got the green light. Rev up those engines. Let's burn out. Let's do it. Let's not burn out. I meant on tires, figuratively. I don't want you burning out. Break loose. Break loose, yeah. What would happen if we viewed the world around us truly that we've been sent and commissioned and released? How would we react to the problems of this world if we knew we had a green light from the Lord? What would happen with the problems in our workplaces and the questions that are being asked and problems within my own family? What would happen if I knew I got a green light from the Lord? I gave this to you, and I didn't want a big green stoplight. I thought about putting a stoplight up here and all that, but you know what? Here's what's going to happen. We'd leave here going, yeah, I got a green light from the altar, and somebody else will take care of it. I gave you an individual green light for simply this, that you are individually called to do this. You can't wait on your neighbor. You can't wait on the church to do something. You can't wait for a meeting to happen or evangelism night to happen. You can't wait. You have a green light yourself, and you have something to do with this. This is not a corporate thing. This is an individual thing corporately to do together as one. Because we're going to come together and say, you know what I did with my green light? I did this, and this is what I saw. I got rejected, and it was great. You might say, Pastor Lynn, how is that great? Because Jesus said it would happen. Yes. What would the things around you look like? What would you do different if you knew you had a green light from the Lord? Would you lay hands on someone sick and say, you know what, it's not me anyway, he just told me to do it. Why are you laying hands on me? My rabbi told me to do this. That's what he said. Why are you telling me about the kingdom of heaven? Because the one I follow told me. What would happen if you began to view the whole world around you in green? What would happen to your neighbors, to your people you work with, to those you come in contact with, if you truly lived in a green light situation? What would you do? How would you attack the situation? You would be reminded that I'm a sent one, and therefore if I'm sent, I've been empowered, and therefore it's likely he's going to do something with that. Let's stand together. I just want you to shout this out this morning. My green light tells me what?
No.
Now let me ask you individually. What is it saying to you? Somebody? My green light says go, but what, where? What is he saying? Something come to mind this morning? No fear. Anybody else? My green light is saying?
Community.
Community. Good.
Love.
Anybody else?
Faith.
Faith. Prayer. Right where we're at. Obedience.
Share.
Anybody have names in your mind? Places that he's given you a green light to go to. Anybody else this morning? Let's raise those up to the Lord this morning. Raise your green lights up. They're put away. That's okay. You can't get to them. Father, we take our light today and we say we have been commissioned to go by you. We say today that we don't have the answers. We're probably not prepared. And Father, we realize that not everyone will accept it. But God, we are going because you said it. Not because a preacher screamed at us today, not because a preacher said to do it, but we've heard your word today. And God, we said it today that most of us are living in yellow light and that's not where you want us. And so, Father, by our own words, we say, Lord, we want to live in the green light. We want to live in the race. We want to get in it. So send us, oh God. Send us, oh God. We're ready to leave this place with your word. God, I am so ready. I'm so ready to be seeing the lost being found, the broken being healed. God, those that are deaf to hear, the blind to see. God, we're ready to see cancer broken. God, we're ready to see addictions broken. We're ready to see marriages healed. We are ready to see families restored. We're ready to see the lost ones coming home. God, we're ready. God, we're putting away the red and yellow lights. We're ready to share. We're ready to go. And so we won't wait anymore. And so have your way. We hear you, Rabbi Jesus. We are your disciples. Therefore, we will go. We will go. We will go. In Jesus' name. We will go in your name and in your power, knowing that you have anointed us for such a time as this, God, that you've anointed us to accomplish your word today. And so, Lord, we go in your name and in your power. And we thank you for the green light, Lord, that you want to get us involved. And Lord, we probably need more healing. Can I say this as we're praying? You need healing, there's no doubt. I'm not pushing down the idea that you don't need that. And I'm not saying that there's not places in your life that need to be healed. But I want to say this, and I want to challenge you with this simply. That sometimes that healing and those answers come when you're out there. Sometimes he's waiting for you to take the step. And those answers will come when you go. It's amazing what happens when you start preaching the word of Jesus Christ, when you start praying for the sick. All of a sudden, your needs start seeming not only smaller, but he starts answering those prayers like never before. And so, Father, we go now in your name. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and grant you peace and the power to live and to go, knowing you have the green light. Go in his name. God bless you.